Our text for consideration this morning from Exodus chapter 3, I'm just going to reread the first paragraph. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I'll go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Dear friends in Christ Jesus. So what would your reaction have been standing there? What would the look on your face have been if you saw what Moses saw? A bush burning in the desert would not have been really all that surprising. It would have been fairly normal. A flash of lightning strikes and a spark is created, and a bush in the desert is just so deathly dry that it goes right up. And it probably burns completely down within a matter of minutes. And if there's a breeze, that probably catches another spark and sends it to the next bush, and you got a little desert fire going, and it's probably fairly common. But Moses looks at this one, and he probably has to do a double take. It doesn't make any sense. It's like looking at a magic trick. Like, how is this happening? It's not burning down. It's not smoldering out. It's not spreading. It's just burning. And then it talks to him. It says his own name. So now the trick is up. God is talking to Moses. God has appeared to Moses. And here's where we want to go this morning. There's something that compels each of us. To say whatever it is we say, to think whatever it is we think, to do whatever it is we do. Something must compel us. And so do you know what that is? What is it that compels you on your good days and on your not so good days? The Lord would teach us this morning through his word, through his servant Moses, what compels us to serve the Lord in awe. Exodus chapter 3. We back up just a little bit to set the stage for Moses. You remember Joseph's brothers sold him as a slave to Egypt. And the Lord blessed Joseph in Egypt to rise up in power, to save basically the world at that time from the famine that was taking place. All of his family, all of his brothers come to him in Egypt. He forgives them. And they all move to Egypt. So now that's the very beginning of God's nation of Israel. Very small at this point. They're all living in Egypt. And a couple hundred years go by. Joseph and all of his family die, but this nation of Israel grows and grows and grows exponentially. God's people numerous in size. They forget all about Joseph in Egypt. They forget about all the good things that he had done for them. And now they look at this growing nation of Israel and they think, well, now it's time to put them under our thumb. They enslave the Israelites in Egypt and treat them harshly and ruthlessly. And yet, despite their treatment, the nation keeps growing and keeps doubling down in size. Finally, Pharaoh makes the law. All Israelite baby boys must be killed. One Israelite mother decides to defy that rule. She puts her baby in a basket down the Nile River. And who should find him and rescue him? It's Pharaoh's own daughter. And thus, this baby boy is now raised in Egyptian royalty, and that's, of course, Moses. Just think about the irony that's been set up now. This Israelite boy who should have been killed is now living in Egyptian royalty while all of his own people around him are slaves in that place. Moses, of course, grows up and he learns who he really is and who his people really are. As a young adult, he decides, I want to try to help them. He sees one of his fellow Israelites being savagely beaten, and he ends up
killing the Egyptian slave driver. And yet his own Israelite people, they don't rally to him like he thought they would. Instead, they think he's just kind of crazy. So he flees. He flees Egypt. And now who's Moses? He's a person with no people, right? He's never been with his Israelites. He's never been truly an Egyptian. He's a person with no people and no home. Moses is now a nobody from nowhere. He spends the next 40 years of his life doing nothing, really. He's tending a flock of sheep that aren't even his. A nobody from nowhere. If you ask Moses at this time in his life what compels him and what motivates him, he would probably say nothing. That is, until this day, the day the Lord appeared to him. Moses thought to himself, I'll go over and I'll see this strange sight, why this bush doesn't burn up. And when the Lord saw that Moses had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Now just think of this. Moses would have had a very, very foggy idea of who the true God is. Remember, he grew up in Egyptian royalty with all of the Egyptian false gods. He would have had a very foggy idea of who the true God is, if any idea at all. He doesn't know who this is talking to him from a burning bush that doesn't burn. So God introduces himself to Moses. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you're standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And at this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and bring them up out of the land and into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now go, Moses. I'm sending you to set my people free. So how's that? The introduction is over. And how's that for motivating and compelling a nobody from nowhere? You're going to go back to where you came from, the land you know so well, and you're going to set my people Moses, who are also your people, you're going to set them free. Moses says, I don't know if I can do that. This leads us to two questions, and these are the two questions we want to consider right now. Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Egypt and bring the Israelites out? God said to him, I will be with you, and this will be a sign that it's I who have sent you. When you return to this place, you'll worship me on this mountain. Then Moses said, suppose I do go, and I say to the Israelites, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what's his name? Then what should I tell them? So Moses asks two questions. The first question is, who am I? And the second question is, who are you? And that's really what this whole text boils down to, is those two questions. That's also really what any discussion about what compels us and what motivates us comes down to as well. Who am I? And who are you? Moses is doubting himself, isn't he? He's questioning whether he could ever do this. Who am I to go and serve you and do this great thing? I can't do that. Who am I to serve you? I don't know if I ever could. I'm a nobody from nowhere. Now, we do well to note that this isn't just a model example of godly humility. Mixed in with Moses' fear and his self-doubt, he also probably just doesn't want to. Who am I to go and serve you? He's probably also got a mixture of his own failures. Looking back on his life in Egypt, he tried to help his people and he couldn't. He's probably very angry. It's probably been many years of this kind of anger and bitterness and self-doubt all just sitting and stewing. And who am I that I should go and serve you, Lord?
that kind of an attitude, when it gets time to sit within us, it compels us. It compels us not to serve the Lord. And whether in a similar way to Moses or whether in a different way, we've all been right there with him. And maybe that's where you find yourself now. Who am I to serve the Lord with my life? And again, we're not talking about a model of humility, but rather when we're honest with ourselves, sometimes we just don't want to. I'd rather serve myself. I'd rather be served. I'd rather focus on all of the reasons not to serve the Lord. And that's a list that we add to daily. I'm just too busy. I'm just too angry about how I was treated or how I failed when I tried last time to even try again. Who am I that I should serve the Lord with my life? Who am I to glorify God with the life that I live when, again, we're honest with ourselves and oftentimes our life does the opposite of glorifying God? Who am I? When we look at ourselves, Moses was looking at himself. We look at ourselves and that seems like the only right answer. When God says go, we say, why should I? But notice, God wasn't sending Moses to go and do this great thing for him because of who Moses is. Listen again, all the things that God said about himself. I'm the God who made all of these promises to your forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm the God who has heard the cry of my people, and I am very concerned for them. I'm the God who has come down to rescue them, and I am the God who's sending you, Moses, and I'm going to go with you. In other words, Moses, don't go to Egypt and do this great thing because of who you are. Go and do this great thing because of who I am. And this is the key for each and every one of us. Listen to all the things that God has told you about who he is. I'm the God who kept my promise to send you and this world a Savior. I'm the God who has heard your cry for help, for rescue, for mercy, for deliverance. I'm the God who has come down to save you. And this whole world, a world full of people that would rather serve themselves than give glory to him, and knowing that he came anyways. And he says, I'm the God who will go with you. He'll go with you by continually forgiving your sins by his death on the cross. Who'll go with you by delivering you from death to eternal life with his resurrection. Who'll go with you by giving all of that which Jesus did to you by faith in the waters of your baptism. Who'll continue to go with you, teaching you all along the way in his word and feeding and strengthening your soul in his body and blood. In other words, don't go and serve the Lord with your life. Don't go and glorify him in all of the things that you love to do. Don't go and do any of that because of who you are. Go and do all of that because of who he is. This is what compels us. Who am I? Who are you? Again, Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and I say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me, and they ask me, well, what's his name? Then what shall I tell them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God says his name, I am who I am. I could spend probably a thousand more hours standing here preaching, and I would never come close to doing justice to what that means. God calls himself, I am who I am. I won't take a thousand hours, but I'm going to try. In that name is the sum and total of all of existence. The absolute of all of existence in that name, God is.
There is no more basic of a fact than that. God is. And there's also, at the same time, nothing more ultimate than that. God is. All of that just in that name. And in that same name, there's also the absolute constant of all constants. There's no force that works upon God. There's nothing that weakens him or takes away from him. There's also nothing that energizes and recharges him. Simply and constantly, he is. And also in that name is this objective reality. Objective in the sense that it matters nothing whatsoever what anybody thinks or feels or wishes or wants him to be. It makes no impact whatsoever on who he is. All that stuff is awesome. All that stuff is really amazing. It makes us say, wow. It causes us to stand in awe of him, and it should. God told Moses, take off your sandals. This place where you're standing is holy ground, not because of the sand, but because God was there. Of course, we should be compelled, and we are compelled to stand in awe of God, of course. But if it ends there, if that's all we hear, then we're also still probably absolutely terrified because of our sins. None of those awesome, amazing facts matter unless I am who I am comes to us in mercy and in love and in forgiveness, like an all-consuming fire that doesn't consume us. And that's who Jesus is. That's exactly who your Savior is. I am who I am in all of that great and awesome and amazing and eternal and constant power. Come to you to die for your sins on the cross. And so now we are properly compelled. Now we are properly motivated, not just to stand in awe of God, but to serve him in awe. To give our lives in service to him. We can properly answer the question, who am I? We're now no longer nobodies from nowhere. Now we are God's blood-bought servants and children. And so just like he said to Moses, he says to us, now go, and I'm going to go with you. And so, dear Christians, don't go because of who you are. Go because of who he is. Compelled to serve him in awe. Amen. Please stand. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard our hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.